Now that we've discussed our calculation for rates of substances, average rates of substances, we can start to talk about how we can relate the rate of one substance to another. We're looking at a graph here again, going back to or continuing with our decomposition of hydrogen peroxide reaction. Now that we have a little bit more complicated equation here, we have to figure out in our graph which substance in here belongs to which curve. Hopefully you can see the easy one to figure out is our reactant. So remember, all reactants will always decrease over time. We only have one curve that is decreasing, and that is this blue one that starts with an initial value. And so the blue one must be our hydrogen peroxide curve. So now we need to look at our two product curves. Remember, products start at zero, and determine which one of these curves, the orange or the black, is water and which one is oxygen. Realize that rates of substances can be determined, relative rates can be determined by coefficients. In first semester chemistry, we learned that balancing, of course, helps to maintain conservation of mass as a reaction happens. But we can also use these coefficients to determine relative rates of substances. So realize, of course, again, we're measuring time on the x-axis and concentration on the y. With my coefficient of 2 for water, what that means is that I'm producing twice as many molecules or twice as much change in concentration in the same time span as oxygen, right? These are reacting in a 2-to-1 ratio. And so that means that water should have the steeper curve, which we see here with the black curve. And so water has to be our curve here in the black. Our oxygen then is the curve in the orange. Again, because water is reacting twice as fast as oxygen, it will have a steeper curve. So the higher a coefficient, the faster a substance will react, the larger a change in concentration over time. We can relate that correlation between rates of substances in an equation called a rate expression. So again, we have here our reaction of the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide. The equation that we're setting up here, when we say that we're calculating rate, we are literally calculating the rate of a reaction with these equations. And notice in here, I have the rate of substance. Right? If I just took this portion out, that is the rate of change of hydrogen peroxide. And to calculate the rate of reaction, I simply divide by its coefficient. Again, remember, reactants are going to be negative because they decrease over time. And notice that I'm setting this equal to the next quantity. And that is because for a given reaction, there can only be one value of rate. If I want to calculate the rate in a given time interval, so I'm assuming all of these delta T's are for the same time interval, there can only be one value for the rate of reaction. And so I can also calculate the rate of reaction looking at the rate of change of water, all right, the rate of that substance, change in concentration over time, divided by its coefficient. And again, set equal to the rate of change of oxygen, change in concentration over change in time divided by its coefficient. So there's an implied one in front of that. This setup is called, again, a rate expression. It allows us to calculate the rate of reaction from the rate of a substance. So the net thing to remember is if you're ever asked to calculate the rate of a reaction, we need to know the average rate of a substance divided by its coefficient. Three notes about rate expressions when you're asked to write one or interpret one. Again, remember that reactants are going to be negative because they decrease over time. Products are going to be positive. We divide the rate of a substance by its coefficient. So coefficients are included in the denominator. And then every one of these components is equal to the others because they're all calculating the same quantity. They're all calculating the rate of reaction. On our next slide, we have some practice questions. So again, a reminder, this is our rate expression for hydrogen peroxide. In these slides, I give these for practice. So here, when I ask you to write the rate expression for the following unbalanced equation, first of all, recognize we need to balance it so we know our coefficients. And the answer is included here, but I strongly encourage you to cover that answer to make sure that you know how to write this without the answer being there. And then to truly test if you understand a concept, you should be able to work a problem in both directions. So if I give you a rate expression, you should be able to write the balanced equation for that. So again, I recommend that you work through this and try to cover the answer to make sure that you get the right answer. Now, once we know our rate expression, this gives us a way to perform further calculations for a given reaction. So again, sticking with our decomposition of hydrogen peroxide, we're told that hydrogen peroxide disappears at a rate of 0.20 molarity per second. Again, notice this is given as a positive value, even though it's a reactant, it has a positive rate. From that information, we want to be able to calculate the rate of appearance of water, the rate of appearance of oxygen, and the rate of reaction. For numbers 1 and 2, we can use one of two methods. And you're allowed to use either method. They both give the same answer. They're just different ways to get to the same thing. The first one is to use the rate expression as a mathematical equation. And that's what's shown down here in part A. So notice down here, what I've done is I've broken out the two key parts of my rate expression, my given of hydrogen peroxide and the unknown of water. And so I can manipulate this equation to solve for, realize if I'm asked to solve for the appearance of water, that means I'm solving for the rate of a substance. And so I want to solve for just the change in concentration over change in time. That means in this equation, I would have to isolate the average rate component. So in order to do this, I would have to multiply both sides by 2. All right, that'll cancel out that subscript or that denominator 2. And so then I can use my given rate of disappearance of hydrogen peroxide to calculate the rate of water. And so the rate of water would be a 2 over 2. I've just pulled out these two numbers. And then I would use my given rate of hydrogen peroxide multiplied by those. Again, remember, obviously 2 divided by 2 comes out to be a simple 1. My given rate of hydrogen peroxide was listed as a 0.20 molarity per second. And so then we can see that the rate of change of water in the same time interval would still be 0.20 molarity per second. The second method, again, you can choose which method to use. The second method is using stoichiometry, basically what we just looked at from our graph. So here I'm given my rate of disappearance of hydrogen peroxide, 0.20. So molarity per seconds are the units of that, right? Moles per liter per second. And here I've just pulled out and mentioned specifically that this is how many moles of hydrogen peroxide I have. From a stoichiometry perspective, then I'm looking at my mole-to-mole ratio of moles of hydrogen peroxide to moles of water, where I again have a 2-to-2 ratio. So notice mathematically, what I've ended up doing is the exact same thing in my stoichiometry method as what I did in my rate expression method. So when set up correctly, either method will work, and you get to choose which one you would like to do. What I'll encourage you to do is to use these methods to practice calculating the rate for oxygen. And what I'm going to do is show a quick calculation for how we determine the rate of reaction. Bear with me one second. I'm going to add in a new slide here so we can calculate this. We don't need that. All right, so remember for the rate of reaction, our setup for this is simply the rate of any substance divided by its coefficient. So if I want to calculate from hydrogen peroxide, we were given that its rate is 0.20 molarity per second, and it had a coefficient of 2, so our rate of reaction should be 0.10 molarity per second. Now, for fun, we can confirm this because we also just calculated the rate of water that turned out to be the exact same value for the rate. So 0.20 molarity per second divided by its coefficient, and we confirm that we do in fact get the exact same quantity. So again, remember for the rate of reaction, there is only one possible value for a given time period. So one more quick set of practice calculations. We're going to work through writing the rate expression for this given equation here. So again, remember a rate expression, we are calculating the rate of reaction. Reactants are always going to be a negative. Change in concentration over the coefficient times the change in time. The one is optional in here. It doesn't need to be included. Carbon is also a reactant, so it will also be negative. Change in concentration over its coefficient times change in time. And then remember, these are all equal to each other. My SIC is a product, so it's going to be positive. The positive isn't necessary. I like to include it in here just as a reminder for myself that it is a product. But it is optional. And then our change in concentration of carbon monoxide divided by 3 times our delta T. So this would be our rate expression. For question number 1, I'm not going to work through the full solution, but just to show the shortcut version. So again, realize when we're given the rate of disappearance of SiO3, we're told that it is this quantity. And realize we can use a shortcut of stoichiometry to calculate the other quantities. So when I ask you to show work, I do need to see steps. Here I'm just walking through a fast way to check your work. So realize if I want to calculate the rate of disappearance of C, I'm looking for just the change in concentration over change in time. I don't want the 4 in there. That 4 calculates the rate. What I do need to recognize is that SiO3 and carbon react in a 1-to-4 ratio. Carbon has a higher coefficient. It should react faster. It should have a higher value for rate. And in fact, it should be 4 times the quantity of the SiO3. So when we do 4 times that, with our sig figs, we get a 1.0 molarity per second. So this does not count as sufficient work, but that is the shortcut version to check your answer. Again, knowing that carbon must be a higher quantity. Right. Carbon has the largest coefficient. That should be the highest value for rate for any of our substances. Also recognize that SiC should be easy to calculate because it's in a 1-to-1 ratio with SiO3. And so SiC rate would be the exact same as the SiO3. So I'll ask you to calculate the rate of CO. See if you can find the quick way to do that. The answers are in your slides. And then, of course, the last thing to calculate is our rate of reaction. Realize the easiest way to do this would be to use a substance that has a coefficient of 1. Because there's no other math to do, the rate of that substance is the rate of reaction. And since we were given 0.25 molarity per second for SiO3, that means that is also the rate of reaction. Again, you can use any of the other substances, all four of those, to calculate rate of reaction, and you should get the same value. At the end of a given section in the PowerPoint slides, I will have examples listed down here. These are more examples that cover the same types of calculations and concepts that have the solutions in there. And then I will also often have follow-up practice calculations. These are not ones that we will work through in class, but they are questions with the solutions posted here. So like always, I'll recommend that you work through these, covering the answers, and then check yourself to make sure that you're getting the concept. And that finishes our discussion on rate expressions.